presentation will be recorded. So by the end of this week, you'll have this video available, and you can always go back and view it. So I have a question to test my mic from my side, make sure. Yes, my mic is working. You probably have to connect and make sure that you can hear me. So let's make those tests, please. Just so I can write the chat. You have to call the conference and check your microphone and use computer for audio. Let's make sure, can everybody else hear me? There's a, Peter Chuck says no audio. Okay, let's see. Let's check here. Hello? Let's see. Okay. Vince Quesada is telling me that people can hear me from the computer audio. Okay, so people can hear me. So you just have to make sure, everybody has to make sure that you connect to the audio. Okay, great. So let's get started after this test. If somebody cannot hear something, you know, if there's a question, you can wait either until the end. Or you can actually type in on the chat. There's a chat feature if you take your mouse all the way up, and we can go forward this way. So we're going to be talking about the design of deep excavations, we're not going to be covering everything in a single hour. In fact, because there was such a high demand for this series of webinars, we're going to be presenting a second series of webinars next week, and the third series of webinars, but not with exactly the same topic that we're doing today. It will be additional material that can be covered with more examples and so on. So I always like to start off with this slide, soil at rest. So this is our excavation contractor. This is our soil relaxing by the beach. I was sitting for a few thousand years at rest. And after a long time, an excavation contractor started disturbing me. I was stressed beyond my strength, boiled up, and finally blew my excessive pressure in his face. I thought he knew I was more than just my SPT, urine in situ soil. So this tells you that, you know, with excavations, and with this, you know, we all excavated, I hope, by the beach at some point when we were young, and we're still fooling around with our kids. We have to be careful about what our soil is. We have to pay attention. It's vital. And the topics that we're going to be covering, first of all, we're going to be looking at the philosophy of deep excavation design. We're going to be seeing and identifying the critical issues, understanding how the soil responds, looking at the technical investigations that are required for deep excavation design, look into the different wall systems, the support systems that need to brace the wall, the analysis methods, and for there's also design codes, design examples, and case histories. We will leave this for the second series of webinars next week. We'll keep everybody posted. First of all, we'll have to look into the definition of a deep excavation, or at least our purpose. We call an excavation typically deeper than 10 feet, although most of you have gone much deeper than that. That requires structural support. In this webinar, we'll be we're examining vertical cut excavations that require structural support. And that will be perhaps if you can imagine a wall with some ground anchors and excavating on one side, or looking at the subway station with the steel braces and reinforced concrete walls. But generally, that's the idea of what we will be looking at. So first of all, a deep excavation is a system that has to retain earth, water, and neighboring structures. Those structures can be buildings, infrastructure like sewers, and so on. there's always unknown factors and risks. We always have to protect adjacent properties, make sure they don't get damaged. We have to comply, we have to look into the different design issues. We have to look into the code issues, depending where we are in this world, and make sure that we're complying with the building code. We always have to construct, design an economical design. We don't want to be over-conservative. And we have to make sure that our design is constructible. And of course, you know, as engineers, right, we're really taking some chances, but we want to make sure that we're on the low spectrum of the regions where there's a very low risk of something going wrong. And if there is, you always have to keep an eye and make sure that everything is going well. So when I set out and I said, okay, how would you point out approaching designing a deep excavation? I came out with this procedure, and in fact, all right, you can almost take this procedure in any sort of geotechnical project and apply it. You can, of course, you can modify it, but the idea is that there's dynamic circles between different phases of the whole process. So first of all, we have to talk to the owner and understand what the owner is and identify critical issues. We have to determine the design life for our excavation. Is it a temporary or permanent excavation? Always look for similar projects and local experience. Based on that, we have to design our site geotechnical investigation. Once we get and this also depends with preliminary concepts, we have to talk to the owner, develop preliminary concepts for deep excavation design, and we might have to go back and redo our site and geotechnical investigation if we found something which is out of touch, or maybe if we need additional information. So we're going to be reevaluating doing the circle with the preliminary concepts, and finally reaching a final analysis and design. Then we're going to be procuring, and we're going to be communicating the projects to the contractor and the issues, and we're going to be constructing that deep excavation. But at the same time, you have to make sure that you monitor that everything goes according to plan and that it's safe. If something is off, you don't want to be running like some of the failures that happened in some parts of the world. But if you have to run, you're going to have to run. But you have to make sure that everything goes according to plan, or learn from what has gone wrong, and hopefully that what has gone wrong is very small. With deep excavations, you have to make sure that you recognize that everything is a staged construction. So we're starting off, even the wall construction in the very beginning can have effect on the performance. We're usually starting from at rest conditions where there's lateral pressures locked in from the ground without anything being done. Then we're doing a cantilever excavation. We're putting a brace in this example, or another type of support. We're excavating further, removing the watering, and we repeat this process until we reach all the way to the bottom of the excavation. But the idea is that your excavations are always it's a staged construction process, and you always need to look at your excavation, even from the design perspective, as a staged construction process. You shouldn't just be looking at the final stage. You have to take a look into all the intermediate stages before. Some of the issues that we have to look is soil and rock properties. We have to estimate them. We have to look at the adjacent structures, their condition, what type of they are, if they're brick, if they're sensitive, if they're concrete, if they're supported on piling foundations, and what kind of loads we're expecting that they exert on our deep excavation. We have to determine the design water levels, groundwater maybe, or water if we're building in a river. We have to select the appropriate earth retention system, examine the different possible failure modes, select our analysis methods, make sure that we are compliant with the building codes, and minimize deformations, wall deformation, surface settlements, and so on. An excavation is always built in soil. Amers is asking if there is sound. People can hear sound. Let me actually type in just a second. There is sound. You need to select Okay, if somebody, you need to select use computer or audio. If somebody cannot hear this, there will be a video recording of this at the very end. So I apologize, but you have to use that option, use computer for audio. Now, as engineers, we ask questions about, you have to ask questions about our soils. First of all, what type of soil this is, if it's a gravel, sand, clay, silt, clay, or something else. Where it came from, it's geological history that has an effect and it will tell you a lot of things about its origins and how it might behave. When it was deposited, if it's a recent deposit or an old deposit, and how are we going to be affecting that soil when we do the excavation? So, you know, all these questions, you know, you can ask, you should ask, and they're going to give you an answer. You know, we have to understand both the structure and the soils in deep excavations. Now, if we look at an idealized soil response in excavations, we have the before and after. It almost looks like a commercial. So before, we are having initial vertical stress and at rest lateral earth pressures. And as we're excavating, we're relieving theoretically some of that stress here. And our K naught pressures at rest go smaller towards KA progressively, theoretically. And this is what we call really a compressive behavior, because this soil element tends to get squeezed in. On the excavation side, on the other hand, we're removing some of the vertical confining stress, and the lateral pressures, because the wall tends to move this way, so the lateral pressures increase, and this basically tends to be squeezed like that. So this is what is being called really a tension behavior. If you have soil under the wall, this will be a shearing response. So depending on where you are, actually the soil will behave in a different way. Now, we have to discuss a few things about soil strength. I'm sure most of you are aware of these things. And just to keep in mind one thing, usually tension strengths are smaller than compression strengths, although in most of our designs we're assuming the same, or we were assuming an average. There is different response between sand and clays. A sand with even some small cohesion, if we model it according to Moore Coulomb, you know, we'll have a shear failure envelope which looks like that, which has an effective cohesion, an effective stress, and a tangent of the friction angle. Clays, on the other hand, are a different beast on themselves. So I always say that clays are like sponges. They have absorbed so much water, and they don't want to go let off it. They're water-filled, they love water, but they're very low permeability. And I'd like to think of clays in a simple fashion, like just like my wife. They resist changes in their state of stress. If I say to my wife, honey, let's do this right now. She goes, no, I don't want to do this, Dimitrios. I'm resisting this change of stress. So that's how clays are, just like your spouse when they're resisting you, whatever you were asking from them. So in some cases, they're building up negative pressures, what you can almost say as negative emotions, resisting the change that has taken place. Of course, over time, in a similar function, like your wife, these negative pressures tend to go away, but there's always this small, tiny remembrance of this excess pore pressure or this excess negative feelings. But hopefully they diminish sufficiently enough that you can continue to remain married. So looking into clay response, we can basically look into the undrained shear strength here. My wife knows that I'm talking about this thing. She has a full understanding. I said that to her. She was smiling. So we have an undrained shear strength here response. And basically what happens is that theoretically for a clay, wherever you move this, because the clay is always producing excess pore pressures, it will give you the same strength. And this undrained response will be for very quick loading. Now, for clays, what you might consider quick loading or undrained might be 6 months, 1 year. It depends on the clay properties. But when we go into a drained response, a normally consolidated clay will behave more like a sand, And what you have to be careful is that at low strain ranges, where this red line worked before with undrained conditions, on the drained conditions it will not work, that will have failed. When we have over-consolidated clays, there is a drained envelope, but there's also an undrained or over-consolidated envelope here, and this is the effect of apparent cohesion. We have to be careful, and sometimes when you get responses from a lab or with clays, and they're giving you like an effective cohesion and a very small friction angle, that's like a little quiz. In reality, your actual strength might not be like that, but you might have, you know, like the soil doesn't always behave the same. You know, there's a range of strengths. So although you might have measured these things at a different stress, this might actually be your lower value, this might be your average, and this might be your high. So, you know, you have to be always considerate of how you should be judging those clay strengths. There's plenty of useful correlations around. I would just like to say that I don't like the CU notation. I prefer SU. Basically, I will say CU is for they're basically referring as undrained cohesion, but the reality is that it's SU, it's an undrained shear strength. Again, for those of you that cannot hear, let me chat. Use computer for audio. Okay, going forward, when we look at the elastoplastic response, there is a linear elasticity soil model going forever, nonlinear elastic, but we definitely expect the soils never elastic. So we are going to have an elastoplastic response. At some point, the soil will yield. A very popular model is elastoplastic with hardening. And what we really want, you to focus on is the reloading part. So we're loading the soil up here, it's sort of yielding, it's hardening. And then when we're removing stress, it goes a little bit here, but it's, this response is stiffer. And on the excavation side, this will be where we are, whereas in the retained side will be here on that region of the elasticity. And our reloading models will be, tend to be three to five times as a general rule stiffer than our loading modules here. And again, we have conditions where we can model our soil as perfectly elastic, perfectly plastic, EP, or we can, this is a case where you really have to be careful, where you have a strain softening condition. This could be at slopes where you exceed your peak strength and then the soil progressively becomes unstable. So I would really urge you to carefully look if you have a situation like that. Now there's plenty of recommendations around. So I found this really nice table which I use when I design piles. But what is conservative for piles might not be conservative for deep excavations. So you always have to come back with and say, okay, I found these recommendations around. Where did these recommendations came from? Are they applicable for deep excavations or not? So always be considerate and, you know, judge where you're getting your design values from. Looking into the geotechnical and site investigation, I always urge people to make a site visit. I know in some of those big offices that work with a lot of people all around the world and pass designs around, maybe that's not entirely possible. You must have relevant information on the site, historic, what buildings were there, utilities and so on, geologic. One of the biggest issues for claims is abandoned structures or historic structures that were not identified early on the site investigation. You have to identify code requirements for your geotechnical and site investigation. And also identify what lab, what tests you will need in situ and lab. If you have clays, I strongly, like even when you do your preliminary investigation, take a little pocket vein penetrometer or something and take some strengths out of the clay. It's going to be, you know, it's going to take like five more minutes on the engineer that's doing the test, but you cannot just have SPT tests on clays. It's not really the correct way, I mean, okay, if you have sands, you can go with SPTs. I understand. It's very difficult to do some tests there on the lab. You could even do them if you want, but you know, we have to advance our state of knowledge of the soil properties beyond block counts after 100 years of doing block counts all the time. I mean, I know that it was a big project in New York City. They had 100 years of boreholes, no laboratory tests, and only SPTs. So after 100 years of borings with 200 boreholes, we knew the same thing that we knew 100 years ago. And that's not the way to do things. So I'll say, you know, determine your, and monitor your groundwater levels. Be considerate of when you're monitoring your groundwater levels if it's summertime, because in that case, your groundwater might be low, you might want to rain, and especially if it's a winter and so on. You have to identify the depth of your investigations, and you have to make sure that you might have to account when that your owner might require that the excavation goes deeper in the future. So, you know, instead of requiring 3 basement levels, say, you know, I want 5 basement levels now. Well, okay, go ahead and design this, but you don't have any sort of information below that. So you might say, okay, now that you want 5 levels, you know, we might actually need to do an additional borehole just to confirm what is under there. And we have to come back with realistic and conservative estimates of our soil properties. We have to identify the critical locations of where the borehole will be located, probably next to sensitive buildings and structures. A general recommendation is to extend the boreholes at least 1.5 times your excavation height and a minimum of 3 meters in rock. And there are some minimum code requirements regarding spacing. New York City incoming building codes is one such example where there is a boring required every 50 feet. That's almost every 18 meters. Some useful tips on soil properties. If you assume just even the slightest cohesion, which is realistic, I would say, it will make a lot of difference in deep excavation design. You have to be considerate of how your soil properties might vary around the site. Just because you did an average or a conservative average doesn't mean that there is a location which is more conservative, which is more critical than the others. So that's why we're saying you have to look for spatial variability and soil variability. Look out for problematic soils, grinds, silts, soft organics, normally consolidated soft clays, fissure clays, others like very soft unconsolidated sands. If you find the clay on a mountain, be very careful. Usually clays like that indicate that there's a general global stability problem. And I always say draw your soil profiles along the excavation and make your cross-sections showing exactly how the soil varies along your perimeter, and make cross-sections that are representative of what you're looking at. Looking into the wall systems that are available. A wall is the main structural system that provides earth retaining support. With the exception of cantilever walls and some circular shafts, most walls require bracing. We can classify walls as temporary or permanent based on how they're constructed, as drilled, cast in place, driven, soil mix. There's other types as well. Based on the wall rigidity, we can classify the walls as flexible, rigid, or semi-rigid. And if they allow water in or not, as watertight or permeable, there's nothing that's totally waterproof. Water will always find a way in. So looking into the basic options of different wall types, there's more wall types available, of course. We have our typical soldi pile or Berlin type walls with lagging. Now we're showing timber lagging here, but it's quite common in other parts of the world that shotcrete is used. So we have our reinforced concrete piles at some spacing. Common in the US is an I-beam. This can be also installed within a hole, a grouted hole. We can have pipe piles and double channels. Double channels are preferred in some places of the world because you can actually put the tieback right through the channels. Then we have sheet pile walls, which do offer some water tightness. They're especially popular in cofferdams and river construction, marine construction. And we also have combined king pile systems with single beams or double beams, king piles or pipes. which offer increased rigidity. We also have second pile walls where we have an overlap with unreinforced piles and reinforced piles. Reinforcement can be either reinforced concrete or a steel beam. And then we go to tangent piles where the piles basically touch each other. And now you could have some spacing between the piles, theoretically, if the soil arches without the need to have any lagging. This will not be a watertight system. And then when you go to heavier construction, we have our diaphragm walls or slide walls, as they call in the United States, which are quite common. And it can also be used as permanent supports. And we also have soldier pile and treated concrete, soil mix walls, jet grout. There's also ground freezing, which I didn't cover here. But there, you know, there's different methods of constructing walls. Generally, these walls tend to be temporary. Thick piles tend to be temporary usually, but there have been permanent sheet pile walls. And I will ask everybody to mute themselves here. Let me select all. Yeah, so please don't make any noise because people can hear you. So we'll have our slurry wall, so we have to make sure that we select the appropriate wall system for our condition or our project. Look into some soldier pile walls with lagging and tiebacks with double channel whalers. Another soldier pile wall with shotcrete, rakers, and passive piles. Looking into sheet pile walls in New York, courtesy of some of our clients. And a cofferdam construction for the new tap and zip bridge with sheet pile walls. Slurry walls or diaphragm walls are basically constructed under, by excavating a panel with a bucket. We're putting in some bentonite mud or bentonite slurry or polymer slurry, depending on the conditions. We're lowering the reinforcement cage, and we're starting to concrete from the bottom up. The slurry is placed, and we have a concrete wall in the ground, a concrete diaphragm. Alternatively, we can always do a soil mix wall. Some of our clients here, some of them, and these are quite commonly used soil mix wall. You mix the soil, and eventually you insert in a steel beam or some other type of reinforcement. Looking to the support systems, if we exclude the cantilever walls, as we go deeper, we will need to support our walls with some sort of lateral bracing. Now, we can classify, again, our supports as temporary or permanent, active or passive, with the intent of if we're actually exerting force on the wall system with the active support or not, and internal or external. Internal meaning if the support, the bracing, is inside the excavation, or external if it is outside. So tiebacks, first of all, they're external supports. They're pre-stressed, so they're active, so we are usually applying forces on them or directly on the wall. They can be both temporary and permanent. So if we look at steel struts, sometimes we're pre-stressing them. They're internal to the excavation, so they complicate a little bit our excavation process. But when we cannot install tiebacks to have an open excavation, they're quite useful because it's really our only option that we have, or perhaps one of our few options, to brace the wall. Usually steel struts are temporary, or there have been some permanent cases. You can have also concrete struts in some cases. We can have a deadman type wall arrangement where we tie back a front wall with a back wall with a tie rod. These usually are not pre-stressed. They can be both temporary or permanent. When these guys are used, usually it's a marine project. We can have rakers with passive heel blocks, which was one of the images that we saw before for the soldier pile wall. It is internal to the excavation. Usually these systems are temporary. One of the negatives of this, of the rakers, are they complicate really the floor construction and the basements because they go through the slabs and floors. And we can have a top-down construction where we construct the basement slabs at the same time as we're excavating. Looking into the tiebacks, we have the tieback head. We're applying, we have strands that go to a fixed zone. And basically, we're transferring the forces from the wall to this fixed zone and we have a zone which is called unbounded or free length. When you have tiebacks, it's very critical that you locate the tiebacks beyond your active zone of movements. And it's not really the active zone of movements directly from your excavation site, but you have to go a little bit more. You have to look into the design life and any corrosion if you're doing permanent tiebacks, and if you have very corrosive soils. And you have to look at, you might be getting some stress relaxation and some additional creep with time. Make sure that usually you don't incline your tiebacks too high with a very big inclination angle, because you might be exerting vertical force on the wall, which is significant. We're going to be seeing that in a few minutes. And when we have to determine the strength of the tieback, the geotechnical strength, we have to use some charts to estimate the bond resistance. The bond resistance actually is not a soil property directly. It is dependent on the soil, but it's also depending on how you construct the tieback, whether you're going to have single injected anchors or multiple injected anchors. So there are charts. You're going to be getting that PDF. When we look into the into steel struts, we have, if we look at the staging, we're excavating, we're doing little trench here, we're putting in our cross load brace, and we're repeating that process until we reach the bottom of the excavation. If we want to pre-stress struts, we might have to make a little small arrangement here with a jacking plate, and then we can put the hydraulic jacks here. Although now there's other options like pancake jacks that we can insert directly here and then put our wedges and lock in the stresses. Looking into some internal bracing for a subway station with steel struts. again, steel struts here, pipe. In some parts of the world, it's quite common to use double beams and kickers, diagonal kickers, although this requires a lot more construction time in terms of welding and preparing this arrangement. Whereas if your construction, if your labor costs are more expensive, you prefer to use a single element like a pipe and weld to your whalers. These are whaler beams right here. When we look at top-down excavation, we will construct our walls first, build our load-bearing elements like piles, and build our floor slab starting from the top. Second, little small hole. But we'll be using very small equipment inside, and that will be delaying the excavation process. Now, this might be beneficial for an owner when your real estate market is very hot, and the owner is looking for to get his building as soon as possible completed. So just paying the extra premium on doing the basement might actually save him more on bringing the property to the market, and also on interest payments. Looking at the failure modes, but this is not, of course, an all-inclusive list, we can fail the tieback, the tendon of the tiebacks. We can have a failure between the soil and the grout. We can have a failure by pulling the tiebacks outside of the grouted bond. We can have a failure of the wall in bending. We can have a failure of the wall due to insufficient passive capacity. For cantilever walls, failure by rotation. Now, on the structural failure here, as we mentioned, this could be the structural failure of a strut, of a slab, or any supporting bracing element. If we incline our tiebacks too much or we have sufficient vertical loading, we might be failing the wall due to insufficient axle capacity. Failure by overturning will really be, for braced walls, will be unlikely unless you have a very big seismic event. And this type of failures by sliding and rotational failure, I would say, they will fall really into the global stability analysis. When we're looking into reinforced concrete piles, we have to typically take into account into a shear failure. For steel beams, usually that's not common. We have to look into our groundwater, make sure we don't have a piping failure. And one of the silent killers will be if we have an aquifer. So if you have an aquifer, you really have to identify that your water pressures here are not significantly higher than what this water table is here. In that case, you might have an uplift issue. Looking at some of the failures, this was like a piling failure here. water seeping through the rock and then causing an overall collapse for a diaphragm wall project. This is the famous, infamous, I will say, nickel highway collapse for a subway system in Singapore. It was, in Singapore they have very soft clays and they, most of you know, they got like a lot of movement and there were some other structural issues that compounded to the failure. This is what appears to be an overturning failure from a lot of water accumulating behind the seed pile wall. So now we're going to be looking at our analysis methods. Basically, our analysis methods are used to determine the support and wall forces, displacements, and other important behavior data. Now, we have to recognize that all analysis methods are simplifications of a very complex soil structure interaction problem, and that each analysis method that we have has its advantages and disadvantages. Looking into some of the theory, we have active and passive pressures. Basically, when we consider active and passive, these are like failure states of the soil, theoretically. In reality, if we have designed the wall properly, we'll be subplacing between. So the idea is with sand at least that we're forming an active wedge with the angle here being 45 minus the friction angle by 2 as the wall moves away from the soil. And here as the wall moves towards the soil, we have a passive wedge that's forming, and this angle here tends to be 45 plus 3 plus 2. While this is idealized as a wedge, in reality it might be a little bit curved, so you might get a log spiral response. Looking into our log spiral and lateralized pressures coefficients, those of you that are making some noise, please be quiet. I can't find out who is making that noise, so please be quiet a little bit because there's other people attending. So we have the active earth pressures. A general equation is our active earth coefficient, our vertical effective stress, minus 2 times the cohesion, and the square root of Ka, whereas the passive can be described by this equation. And this is for smooth walls and vertical walls here, although it can be adapted to other walls. That's the equation that we're showing here below. When we look at the KP, there's different ways we can include wall friction or not. There's Rankine, Coulomb, and other Lancelotta and Kakwot-Kirizel values. The idea is that Coulomb accounts for for the surface inclination and by extension wall friction, but we have to be careful with Coulomb. We're going to look into this. So with Coulomb, it's a wedge failure. For the KP, Kakwot-Kirizel, we have log spiral, and Lancelotta, it's a log spiral failure. They all account for wall friction. Coulomb has an equation. Kakwot-Kirizel is tables from French barbers, from what I know, in the 1800s. Lancelotta offers an equation. Coulomb and Kakwot-Kirizel have KA values. Lancelotta has only KP for passive pressures. And the benefit of the Lancelotte equation is that it has a seismic component by an equation. And versus the Coulomb, Coulomb might tend to overpredict KP when we have high friction angles and high wall friction. So I would say Lancelotte is a very good equation for Coulomb, or go to Kakwot-Kirizel for log spiral failure if you don't have seismic. We always have to look into our water. So you might want to do a one-dimensional water flow, or you might want to do a flow net analysis, and we have to make sure that we don't have any uplift issue from the water flow and so on. On our analysis methods, there's basically three types of analysis methods, although there is research right now on neural networks. The idea is that we have our conventional methods where we're assuming the earth pressure behind the wall, and we're using some sort of beam analysis. We have beam or elastoplastic foundations, finite elements or finite different solutions. And there's also neural networks where we input a series of excavations into a neural network and the performance and various parameters. And this way we're teaching the neural networks what to expect from the going forward the response of the excavation. Now, this is mostly a research effort at this time. The advantage of conventional methods is that they're easy to check, but they don't include any, really, they don't account for soil structure interaction. The input is relatively simple, but if you have to do hand calculations, it's quite time consuming. I used to do this by hand before we developed our software programs. That's why actually I developed this. I don't want to be doing this by hand. It takes me 1 week to do that. So then the bimoelastic or elastoplastic foundations, they are sort of easy to check because, you know, we can enter, we can directly control the spring stiffness and the failure limits of the soil springs. We do account for some soil structure interaction. The input is not so straightforward as, of course, with the conventional methods. It's faster than hand calculations usually. And we have the full finite elements or finite difference. They're not so easy to check. They account for better for soil structure interaction. The input is not so straightforward. If you were to do this by hand, there will be no way to do it. You'll be spending an eternity. Although you might draw a nice graph and a nice model, but you know there is a fine parameters that you have to be careful about. They're relatively fast now, depending on the complexity of what you want to model. And in terms of realistic behavior, you know, I put a question mark on all and saying, okay, you know, you always have to be careful. Okay, you don't expect to get realistic displacements with your conventional methods. And with the bimoelastic foundations, you might get more realistic displacements. Or with the finite elements, theoretically, if you have modeled everything correctly, you would expect to get even better. There's a question if we're going to be discussing the deep excavation software. No, we're not going to be. This is basically deep excavation design. This has nothing to do with marketing. On our third series of our presentations in 2 weeks, we will be looking at the optimization of excavation and we will be using the software at that point. Now, some of the results that are shown here, we did this with our software, but you know, this is not the point of this excavation, of this presentation. So looking at conventional methods, we assume basically the lateral earth pressures. We have to determine fixed locations for forces at the subgrade or beneath the excavation. We analyze the wall beam with assumed loads. The advantage is that the method is easy to verify and it gives a back check for more rigorous methods. And the disadvantage is that we're not including any soil structure interaction. So basically in the conventional method, we're totally ignoring the stage construction process. So the idea is that we determine the net loading diagram on the wall. So we assume our lateral earth pressures, whatever assumption we have made. We're calculating our surcharges. We're calculating our net water pressures. Now, if you see net water pressure like that, it means it has come from a flow net or a 1D flow analysis. We might want to add seismic loads. And by adding all those things, we come up back with a net loading diagram. For soldier pile walls, we might have to actually adjust the pressures and incorporate 3D effects. We'll be using the pile spacing to multiply our pressures above the excavation. And then we might have what's called an active width and a passive width and a water width for multiplying these pressures, the active pressures, the resisting pressures, or the water pressures. Then when we have multiple supports or even with other supports, but basically for multiple supports, we'll have to calculate some safety factor for wall embedment. Usually what's done is that we have to take a force equilibrium below the lowest support, or we do a moment base safety factor with driving moments and resisting moments. We're ignoring the loads above the bottom support. And the last way of determining our safety factor is based on the available length, where we determine where our safety factor of one is coming from these two safety factors, and then our safety factor is how much wall embedment we have versus what is required for a safety factor of one, either for the moment or the force. When we look into bimoelastic foundations or elastoplastic, there's different ways of running an analysis. The traditional way has been that we are assuming the driving earth pressures behind the wall, and we use only passive springs Another approach is to use active and passive soil springs. If you do active and passive soil springs, then you can actually account for stage dependency. If you just do the driving pressures with passive springs, you really don't account for any stage dependency or stage construction process. The idea is that we have to estimate the spring stiffness somehow, either from subgrade reaction or from soil elasticity with active and passive wedges. In cases like that, when you have soil springs or if you do a finite element analysis, theoretically, you will have a mobilized passive safety factor. If we were to draw our passive pressures here, it will probably be a line that extends all the way like that. But here we see that our pressures tend to reduce. So our mobilized passive pressures theoretically should be always smaller than our available passive resistance. Now, this might not always be the case. You have to be careful if you get very high safety factors. That, you know, there might be cases where your wall is rotating. And in the finite element analysis, it's actually misleading you to think that the wall is stable. And that's why you always have to look at your displacement. So if you get a lot of displacement, then, you know, be worried that you might be approaching failure. Looking to the finite element analysis briefly, we basically divide the soil in simple elements. We have to define some boundary conditions around our model and our walls. We model the soil with strength and elasticity. We have to model the structures, include the construction stage history. The advantage is that a full soil structure interaction is included. The disadvantage is that this requires a skilled designer to be able to judge that the, you know, the correct input is in and that the correct response or like a reasonable response is obtained. And it's actually quite common from finite element analysis for results to be off by a factor of two or more. Looking into a finite element analysis model with triangular soil elements, walls, braces, surcharges, and also a tieback model with finite element analysis. So the idea is that, you know, you have to be able to make sure that you're modeling all the process correctly. And don't just trust what the software gives you out and that goes out with anything. So with finite element analysis, make sure that you have good input, because if you put garbage in, you're going to get garbage out. That also stands for any other analysis types. It is good to know what you expect. I always say that in excavation, we're looking at small strain stiffness versus large strain, and our soil tends to be much stiffer at smaller strains. In some cases, basal heaves and cantilever displacements tend to get overestimated in finite element analysis. And surface elements might be a little bit out of touch, especially for models that don't include the soil anisotropy. And don't always trust the nice colors that can give you a false sense of assurance. Now, we always have to look into our vertical settlements. Another issue, make sure, you know, we can relate them to horizontal wall movement, wall construction, ground anchors, vibrations, consolidation, or dewatering. Yesterday, there was an engineer that said, you know, on an email that even with an 8-meter excavation soft sands, there was considerable settlement behind 10 meters behind on a historic church. So that was an issue. So you have to be careful about the watering. Other issues that we can look at include 3D arching effects, thermal loads on steel struts, string cuts on concrete slabs, connection details, actually on the nickel failure collapse, connection details and pin piles were some of the reasons that the failure took place. And we have to make sure sometimes that our system is redundant, just in case something goes wrong in the site, an excavator knocks off a strut or something else. So it's nice to make sure that you have some redundancy if something goes wrong. Looking into our cantilever walls, we have the free earth method, fixed earth method. In the free earth method, we're just balancing out the moments. On the fixed earth method, we're assuming a rotation point and we have active pressures, passive, active, active, passive. And we can use the resisting pressure as fully passive, which is quite common, or apply a safety factor on the passive pressures. Looking to the free earth method, we're balancing out the moment, but the shear doesn't balance out, which is not really realistic. So when we get this safety factor here of one, it's not really one, we have to increase the length at least by 1.2 to get to the 1.0 safety factor. And then we have to apply additional safety factors on top of that. Now, I've seen walls in engineers design their excavation with only this 1.2 or 1.3, and it has worked because our the soil properties they've assumed were conservative. Now, I was just doing this example for a typical 30-degree fixation angle soil and a 10-foot excavation, K0.33. That's almost 120 pounds per cubic foot. That's almost 19 kilonewtons per cubic meter for those on the metric wall. We're coming back after all this with a required embedment of 12 feet, roughly 4 meters. So we have to multiply this times 1.2 to get a safety factor of 1.0. And then do the remaining calculations for the moment and so on. When we're doing a single support with the free earth method, we're taking moments about this tieback. You'll see here that they're assuming active earth pressures, but theoretically, if you're applying a pre-stress, you shouldn't have active earth pressures. You might have higher pressures. So the ground angle pre-stress plays a role, so you have to be considered active might not be applicable. Now, active has to have worked and has worked in the past, and the reason, again, I think, is because we have been conservative on our soil property estimates. Again, looking at this excavation with a single support, once we got our wall embedment length, we don't need to increase the wall length for the 1.2 as before for the cantilever walls. We just have to increase our wall length to obtain our required safety factors for rotation or a wall embedment. That's what the output will look like. This is active pressures, although we'll argue that you should be applying apparent earth pressures. And looking to apparent pressures when we have multiple supports, the idea was that Dr. Peck initially and others identified that the load behind the excavation could be somehow, the pressures could be determined by creating an apparent earth pressure envelope for measuring strut loads. Now, I had some private discussions with Dr. Peck while he was still in this world with us, and he did say that the gamma that he's using there is the effective weight when you're below water and that the water has to be added separately. There's always that question about what this gamma is. And there's always a question about what is this reaction at subgrade. So the reaction at the excavation level was never really mentioned. I did a little paper which I'm presenting in March on the IFC conference in San Antonio. So really, the apparent earth pressure envelope is an envelope that captures the maximum force from all stages. You have to keep in mind now, everybody's going nuts here in various manuals and they're recommending how you calculate bending moments from apparent earth pressure envelopes. Well, nobody has measured them, really. Nobody, you know, they measured the strut loads back then and for a long time, but almost nobody has measured those moments and the way that these pressures are analyzed. So, you know, you have to be careful that some of these recommendations might not be actually so reasonable. Looking into different apparent earth pressure envelopes, the idea is that you divide the tributary area method, so you divide one load, and then you get to the reaction at subgrade. Peck had different diagrams for sands, soft clays, stiff clays. FHWA offers, I think, a reasonable approach for determining apparent depth pressures because they're relating that height to where your top support and bottom supports are for the trapezoidal pressures. Now, I would argue that these pressures actually might not go directly to zero here because that reaction at subgrade has, you know, it was never measured, really. Then we might have effects increasing our lateral pressures due to basal instability or when you have soft clays. There's a procedure by Henkel for doing this. We have to look into our basal stability for soft clays. And the basal stability is affected by the dimensions of our excavation and the excavation height. So we're looking now at a soft clay example with the FHWA approach. A stiffer clay over a softer clay. Now you'll notice here that if we strictly follow the FHWA approach with simple span moments, that in reality this part is not fixed because the active pressures here are much larger than the passive, so this will be kicking out. So I just want to illustrate that, you know, we're going out, we're calculating all these apparent depth pressures, and then should we really go and calculate the bending moment with a simple moment diagram? I don't think so, because as we go back, this was going to kick out. So there's no way to just simply assume a simple bending between these two. We'll see this a little bit further down on another example. We have to look into surcharges, theory of elasticity, rigid walls with boostiness. So when we have rigid walls, if we use theory of elasticity, theoretically we have to multiply it times 2. And if you look into train manuals like ARIMA, the surcharge equations that they have actually is boostiness with a load factor of, with a reflection factor of 2. Otherwise, we might take a distribution angle for our surcharges. And if you assume a distribution angle or a Businesque, it can make actually a big difference. So this is a 2 meter excavation, 6.5 feet, with train loads, 11 feet back, almost 3.5 meters. So if we did a distribution angle, the loads are way behind the wall. If you do Businesque theory of elasticity, you have a lot of surcharges that are predicted higher up on the wall. If you assume rigid conditions, you get almost 10 centimeters of displacement, flexible. It's roughly 5 to 2 inches. And if you go with the distribution angle, which is what everybody expects us to behave, you almost have no displacement. And of course, the moments are significantly different. So, you know, you have to always touch yourself and say, okay, how, you know, what is the reality? And it's sometimes when you're talking to these officials from these authorities, it's very hard to convince them that the distribution angle approach might be actually the correct way to go, because they legally have to go by what is in their design book. Looking to the beam analysis methods for multiple supports, we have BLAMS methods, FSWA with simple spans from the Geotechno Circular 4. A mix between FSWA and BLAMS method, we'll look into how, and Caltrans trenching and shoring manual. We'll look into each one of these methods right now. BLAMS method basically works by assuming thin supports and continuous beam, and by getting on our net loading, finding out where the net loading comes to zero, and assuming a virtual support. So then we're doing a beam analysis, continuous beam, and we're getting that reaction to express a safety factor on the passive resistance. We're having available resistance here, and this has a driving force. With FSWA simple span approach, and looking at the same example, which is a 50-foot excavation, almost 18 meters, the difference is that the manual recommends that we fix our subgrade reaction right here. So we're doing simple span, and this is a continuous beam from here to the top of the wall. By doing a modification of FSWA and BLAM, modifying FSWA, again, we have a continuous beam from the top to the bottom, to the second support, a simple span, and again, a simple span moment, but we're fixing the simple span near the virtuals where our net loading gets to zero. In the Caltrans method, Caltrans Trenching and Shoring Manual, California, 2011, again, we have a pin support on the top, so we get the moment until the here. Then it's a simple span, and then we're fixing that virtual support point below by finding out where the moment equilibrium is. So we're finding out where that moment equilibrium is by some moments only below the lowest support, and we're assuming a support point here, which actually will get zero reaction because we see that the shear. So the shear balances out, and the moment balances out. And then we are expressing only a rotational safety factor for the wall embedment by taking forces only below this point. So we only consider the driving moments and the resisting moments here. Now, sometimes the Caltrans approach might tend to produce very high moments. So it's typical to assume some sort of negative moment and bring that cantilever moment, that simple span moment down. The shears don't change from the previous. It's just that we're manually reducing the moment here, so we're bringing this up. This can be done by software, so we're readjusting the moments by somehow to reduce our maximum bending moments. And now, how do the different methods compare? So if we look at Blum's methods, FSWA mixed, Blum, FSWA Caltrans, Caltrans negative, and we also did ammonia analysis. We can see that the maximum support reaction was predicted by Blum's method. FSWA simple span in this case predicted the smallest reaction, whereas everything else predicted the range of about 27.7 to like 32 kips for the support reaction. On the maximum moment, the Blum's method predicted one of the smallest moments, but the FSWA simple span method predicted the smallest moments of all. And you know, I really have an issue with that approach, but I don't think it's really appropriate. This should be corrected in FSWA. The FSWA mixed and Blum went to 74, and the nonlinear analysis had a range between 65 and 86, depending on what assumptions you made on wall friction. The Caltrans method produced the highest moment, and the negative moment was really more in touch with the higher end of the nonlinear analysis. So what you have to keep in mind is that depending on what you choose for your analysis method, you can get a different range of answers for both your support reactions and your wall moments and so on. Now, we also did the seismic case, but this is, you know, I'll leave this up to you to read afterwards when you get the PDF. One of the things to keep in mind, you have to, we can make the comparison of the pre-stressing effect. So when you're pre-stressing your wall more, you're gonna be reducing your wall displacement. So we had active FSWA peg pressures, different wall displacements. The active air pressure envelope for a limit equilibrium actually produced the biggest moment on the wall. But when we did the nonlinear analysis, the moments were smaller. There were actually some place in between. But we saw that pre-stressing reduces the moments and reduces the wall displacement, and at the same time increases, of course, the support reaction that is being calculated. Going what I always say, when you get air pressures on your design contracts, be very considerate. I will never specify lateral air pressures. I will specify some general accepted methods and soil properties if somebody is to design things. Lateral air pressures are not properties. They're dependent on construction spacing, wall to soil friction, support pre-stress on your wall deflections, on your surface profile. So when you get an apparent test pressure envelope or something like that, you might be safe under same conditions, but if you do something totally different, that same envelope might not be conservative. And sometimes you get this type of apparent test pressure envelopes and recommendations, and oh boy, they have nothing to do with reality in some cases. And well, you know, you might argue that this 24H, okay, where is that H? What is the 24? And what is the soil property that produced that 24? Could you please elaborate? And also, let's have some fun here. So the pressures below the excavation, they're defined as 30D for the active above the water table and 15D. Now this is units for feet. But anyway, when we say, okay, how is this possible? The only way that you make this possible is if you have a unit weight of 125 pounds per cubic foot, 19 roughly kilonewtons per cubic meter, and a friction angle of 37.8 degrees, which gives you a Ka of 0.24. Now, if you go and apply this gamma of 125 or 19 to the passive side where we have a Kp of the passive slope as 300D, the only way to get this with 125 pounds per cubic foot is if your friction angle is 24.32 degrees. So here's an example, perfect example of getting on a very big project, lateral air pressure recommendations which are physically impossible. This cannot happen. So the specs actually did not outline how they came about to define this air pressure. It's probably what they've done forever. They say, oh, this has worked, this is what we do forever, but it's physically impossible. You cannot deduce any soil properties from that. Conclusions. I would say use at least two different analysis methods for your analysis, even if that's limit equilibrium or nonlinear. You have to understand your soil and project needs. If you're going to be left with anything out of this presentation, it's that the soil and the structure interact. And I want you to keep in mind that the lateral earth pressures are not a property. They're depending on a lot of things. With that, all right, I'm going to be organizing another series of webinars next week to cover design codes, allowable stress design, LRFD Euro codes. I'm going to be working out some examples. And on the third week, we're going to be looking into the optimization of excavations using our software. So I really hope that you enjoyed this presentation. Now, if you have questions, you can either write them now on the chat, or you can email me at dimitrios@deepexcavation.com. I really like you to go into that link here on that example. This actually is outlining that example that we looked with the different analysis methods for the limit equilibrium, with FHWA, BLAMS, and so on. I always like to connect with everybody of you on LinkedIn. So you'll be getting this presentation. Please connect with me, and you know, I always like to keep in touch. Thank you very much for attending this presentation. So I'll be happy to answer any questions. Or email me. And the video will be made available at the end of this week, together with the PDF. Okay, there was a question on slide 67. Yes. So we're on slide 67. Yes, the PDF will be emailed also at the end of this week. So we want to make sure that everybody gets together, because we're having two more webinars tomorrow. Okay, on the top-down construction, I'll take you on our website a little bit. Let's see. So if you go to deepexcavation.com, on the top-down construction, and you go on our library, the webinars tomorrow are the same. We're going to be holding webinars next week, which are going to be different. So we have on our website, on the libraries, support systems top-down, and this really illustrates here how the top-down method is done. So I recommend that you go here. The webinar on 27 is the same. So this week, the webinars are the same. Next week, the webinars will be covering allowable stress design, LRFD, design codes and issues, Euro codes, and we're also going to be doing some work examples from the very beginning to the very end. Thanks to everybody. Yes, you will need a separate registration. We'll be emailing everybody, so look at your email and on LinkedIn. So we'll be sending out details. It's going to be the same page to register. We're just going to have three different links or four different links for the presentation, so you can log in. Thanks to everybody.